where it feels like it already. So it's fast approaching. Just wanted to our coaches, NYHA coaches, thanks for being here tonight. I know this is an investment in your time, but it's also an investment in our players and our program. And we're really excited for what's coming, what Troy and Terry and Bob and the team are all bringing me, Paul. So just want to say thank you for being here. I do want to just set sort of, I know this is a little early because we haven't actually placed coaches yet. So I know many of you received an email saying, hey, you've been selected or approved to coach. Basically what that means is like, you're on the list that if, you know, and we still have to place people. So there's obviously no final placements. A lot of it depends on where kids land and where we need coaches. And you know, lots of board moving pieces and learning is coming from that. So just know that if you got the email saying you're approved, that might have, like some people are like, I'm approved, where am I at now? It's just saying, hey, we come, you're somebody that we're interested in. We need to still obviously sort out where everyone will land once team placements happen. So more to come on that. We're working hard behind the scenes to obviously get a little more information on that. I just wanted to sort of level set on that. Otherwise, I'm super excited. I've gotten the opportunity to meet Troy and hear a little about what's coming tonight for the high schoolers. Thanks for being here too. We hope that, you know, our skaters will now have this knowledge when they get to your level, but want to get in to make sure you guys are improving and learning and help them build our program, and you guys can even be mentors and help our younger kids as they learn what our coaches are about to embrace into. So I think that's all I really needed to cover. Thanks, Russ, for overseeing and organizing and getting on the details and the materials.
So some of you may or may not know me, but my name is Russell Barr, and I'm on the hockey ops on the board here. So my plan then with what Troy has brought here, or Terry has brought here with Troy, is to be able to facilitate and support, check in, and give you what you need to be successful. So this year, Rhonda Messerschmidt, she's not able to be here tonight, but she is going to be running 8U, and then I'll have 10U and above. But either of us, you know, if you find during the season you need something or you need support with something or have questions or anything, either one of us. And I think in our last message, both our numbers are on there. So phone, text, person, whatever you need, we're here to support you. So, and I think we're going to be on the right track before we get going on here. So I think most of you may have seen Coach Terry Watkins around the rink once or twice. I think he was coaching before I was born. So, no further ado, I'll let you.
I guess that's where I started. I started coaching here 50 years ago. This year, I actually have a picture of it. My son was 4 and I was 50, or I was, whatever, 25. I coached at the high school, I coached youth hockey, and I coached at the university. And this last year after I retired, I was asked, Stacy asked me if I could maybe help out a little bit with youth hockey, and I was pretty surprised how big it's gotten, how structured it is, and it's awesome from where it was when we started this picture with more than 10 or 12 kids, you thought 50 years ago. But the biggest thing that I saw is we had zero structure. We talked to coaches meetings about practice plans and how we communicate a practice plan. We spent 20, 30 minutes on it when everybody in the room wasn't even doing practice plan, much less communicating. So, what we need is we need a path to follow, we need to implement it, we need some structure, we need some accountability, we need to support our coaches. We've got a lot of volunteer coaches that haven't played a lot of hockey. They need some help, and we need to teach coaches and we need to teach kids. And whenever I've needed help over the years, I've relied on Troy Ward. Troy and I have known each other for probably 35, 40 years. I grew up in St. Paul, Troy grew up in North St. Paul. His dad was athletic director, football coach, I think, correct, North St. Paul High School. Troy played at Eau Claire, won a national championship at Eau Claire, coached as an assistant with the Badgers, won a national championship with Denver, won a national championship, Division I. Coached with the Pittsburgh Penguins, and correct me, I think you guys won a cup when you were a bench coach, is that correct? Is the Neil and Boyce?
Not correct.
Okay, close though? Close, all right. He's coached for Abbotsford Heat in the AHL. He's coached the Vancouver Giants in the Western Hockey League. He's coached the Madison Capitals. He's coached a couple of top pro teams in Europe. He's been the head U.S. scout for the Vancouver Canucks. Over the last few years, he was just named the GM of the Sioux City Musketeers in the USHL. He runs Hockey and Sons and Hockey and Daughters, which is a great summer program for dads and their kids. And he is, like I said, in my mind, one of the really good teams. started with the high school. We were in Richmond, and I was watching Richmond Bantam practice and Pee Wee practice before one of our high school games. And their former head coach, Adam Swan, that played for me a number of years ago, and I saw Adam, and I said, Adam, what the heck are you guys doing here that we're not doing in Menominee? Because it was a total different look when I looked at the ice in the Richmond kids versus our Menominee kids. And he said, we didn't call Troy Ward. And so I called Ward the next day and said, hey, Troy, I'd like to have you help us out here. And so what Troy's going to do is basically, over the next three Monday nights, is give us a plan. How do we coach hockey? How do we approach things? How do you divide and bring offense, defense? How he coaches, how he teaches. And I think that that's something that we have to implement as an association. Squirts, Pee Wee's, Bam, high school, we have to be on the same page. And I think that, that with his guidance, we can take a step in the right direction. We've got some of the volunteer coaches in here, some of the stout kids, and all of our high school kids are in high school. You guys are going to be involved in helping out with some of the young kids. And this is going to be a lot of the stuff that we're going to do at the high school this year. So this is a community effort. And so that's Troy, let's get started.
Awesome. Thanks, Terry. Stacy, everybody else.
I got one shot. There's one button I got for you.
I think I'll be good at it.
First of all, thanks to everybody that's here, certainly on behalf of your spouses, if you're male and female, for allowing you to be here and take time away, certainly for your high school kids. Good opportunity, most importantly, just learn about the game maybe a little bit and just see it from a different perspective, if you would. I'll try and relate it to you as players as well. And for the coaches that are in the room, the volunteers, and the people that are giving their time to help, obviously, thank you for being here and being a part of this. As Terry mentioned, going the next three Mondays, pretty much from whenever. I'll give my time hard, and we'll start at 6:30, and we'll go until we're satisfied. I'll stay longer if somebody wants to stay longer and help. The reason why is most important is the kids. It's the kids. At the end of the day, the better we get as a group, obviously, the more all of our children reap the benefits of sport, right? And hopefully, the way I've always looked at the game, if you're a really good teacher, you should not only be teaching the game of hockey, but you're really teaching life. Because I was taught at a young age that if I can handle the rink, as a player, I can probably handle life. If I can't manage myself inside the rink with referees, teammates, opponents, success, failures, it's probably going to be a tough life to manage outside the rink. That's the way I was brought up in North St. Paul, Minnesota. So I've always stayed with that, and I found it to be true. Those men are really calm all the time, really together. You look at what happens in the, no matter what level you're coaching, or no matter being a high school player, all the things that happen in the rink, if you can handle a rink, you can handle life, in my opinion. It's a lot easier. People that struggle inside, struggle outside. They go hand in hand. So it's usually that way. What I'm going to try and do here tonight is, I like to say I'm going to put arms and legs on things for you. I am going to go back to some basics. If you're fairly an experienced coach, don't mean to be disrespectful. The one thing about being a good teacher is every year when you're a teacher, you start with a brand new class and you go back to letter A, and you start there every year. You never assume that they know something, and you just keep moving on where you picked up last year. You have to go back to the beginning. So let's take this as an opportunity to just grow and learn tonight. I've had no complaints by this comment, by the way, I have none. I really don't. I know what day it is. I couldn't tell you the date. Obviously, look at the date. I couldn't tell you the date right now because all my days blend together. They're just one big mess from going from a new job to another job and other things I got going on. So this is the wrong date. Obviously, I started this process last week, and when I really got into this page, it was the 10th. So when I printed it today, I apologize. So that's who I am. That's my new job. You're going to get all this information. We do have, do you want to hand them off?
Yeah.
The coaches that are here are going to get one of these packets, and you can follow along. I'll let him hand them out, but you can follow along. The rest of you, if you don't have one, you can get one eventually. But I only made so many for today.
Yeah.
Thank you.
I'll
do it. Great. So first of all, as a teacher, I think you always give thanks to where you're at. Like, it's just me. Like, I always give thanks. Like, you're seeing me present to you, but I'm just a byproduct of just having a lot of good people in my life. That's really what I am. I am who I am, but I'm a byproduct of the people around me. So, for certainly Terry, and as he mentioned, our relationship, as he mentioned, I played back when this was fence and super cold, and you know, I played this bar a long time ago. So back in the late 70s, early 80s. So I've been around for a while with Terry, and I appreciate him giving me a chance. Obviously, it wouldn't be anywhere near successful if my wife wasn't successful, if we weren't successful together. So to be a great teacher, you gotta be, things at home gotta be different. That's just the way it is. That's what you always find, even as high school students, if you look at your teachers that you love, they probably got everything going right at home. So you got a good relationship, things are good. So that's the way life works, so I appreciate my wife, Marilyn. You, the coaches, I thank all my former players, my peers, my parents, my two sons, because they helped mold me into a good coach, and certainly my friends in the hockey world, which is Hockey and Sons and Hockey and Daughters, as Terry mentioned. Those are people that I think help me allow, hopefully, to be a good teacher to you tonight. So the next one, I'm not going to say anything about this. We'll click off of this. This is just my path, and I don't use it as anything about me, but I do want to make you understand a little bit about something, about maybe the presentation. So you can go to the, you can go to the next page. But when we get into like my presentation, I'll give you this. How many of you hockey players, we pick on the high school players here or the college guys, how many of you have been told like you found your passion? Hockey's your passion. Somebody in your life has said, oh, you found your passion. Okay, great. I was said the same thing for years, and I think it's good. Like I want you to understand it. I do. But I also want you to understand hockey is really not my passion. I look at it differently, and I always have. Hockey is my obsession. I am obsessed by every aspect of the game, because it all relates to life. So I'm obsessed by people and their capacity to learn, what I can say and how I can say it to make things easier for them. So passionate is usually people will say, good job, you found your passion. That's great, awesome, good for you. And that's all great. I was a passionate guy. Then I became obsessed. When you're obsessed, then people think you're a little off. They're like, ooh, this dude, like, why is he going to be a perfectionist? Why is he here so long? They sit on this edge of they're not comfortable around. I don't want that out of you tonight. I don't want you to be uncomfortable with you, with me. But I'm obsessed. Like, I love the game. Absolutely love it. I do nothing else. This is all I do. And I like to be really good at it. So I've, going back to the page before, I've done everything, you don't have to go back. I've done everything in the game. I've done color. I've done TV. I've been out of hockey. Worked at Bernard's in New Richmond. Coached the New Richmond High School team as a skills coach. I found other things to fill my void when I wasn't coaching on the track that I was on. So I wasn't afraid to get off, but I still coached. And I've coached as much or more youth hockey than I really have even a professional. Every summer I've coached youth hockey ever since I was basically 18. I'm 60 years old. Every summer I've spent at least 8 weeks coaching youth. And that really has made me a much better teacher because of my experience in the summer. Coaching pro is not very hard. A lot of times they coach you. Coaching youth, that changes your language, changes how you think. Okay, so it's kind of an obsession with me. Now we get to this one here. Coaching, teaching, plan. Life, language, and words. Okay, that through again. Okay. Change your words, change your world. So even though I get to sit in the heart of Packerland, let's just take an excerpt of the paper the other day in St. Paul, last week before the opener that we watched yesterday for both teams. And it's about the Vikings offense. Okay? Give you an idea about language, which we're going to talk about today. It's probably the toughest offense I've had to learn, veteran receiver Adam Thielen said. Things are starting to click a bit. You're not having to think so much, which is obviously is huge in this league. You don't want to be out there thinking. what's made the learning the new offense so difficult? Just a lot of verbiage. Think about that. Just a lot of verbiage. You're talking about the best players at the best level. You're talking about Adam Thielen. It's not like this is his second year in the league. These guys have played a long time, but the verbiage has changed so much that this guy's making them think different, but they still have the same skill set, basically, they had last year. A few tweaks. Different routes, different things happen as we watch, if you watch the game for the Vikings, but verbiage changed it. Then the next one was, Thielen said, while explaining that some play calls are condensed down to a single word, sometimes playbooks are a lot of words and everybody knows what to do because the words are tagged or everyone is told what to go through to play the call. This offense is a lot more memorization. So as we get ready to just talk about becoming better teachers, look at the NFL, look at that game yesterday, look at, like, just say a few, Jefferson, look how open he was and the different things that are being cadenced at the line and how it's changed. And the verbiage changed just their whole mindset. So we have to understand as a group of teachers here tonight, a group of learners and our high school players, that how we talk oftentimes will set it. So click again. So change your words, change your world. I'm blind. Please help. Forgive the annotation. Okay? So I asked, would you pull your car over and roll down your window and give? Would you walk by this person on the street and give them money? I don't know. Click again. Would you give that person money? I don't know. But language and how we talk certainly paints a different picture. That's for you to decide, but that's basically saying the same thing in two different street corners, two different signs, two different ways of giving. Okay? I know where I would probably give money. I might give them to both, to be honest with you. But I know one that strikes me different than the other. So that's an example of things we're going to talk about today with our language. Go ahead. Go ahead. Click again. Okay. So now, are these hockey-related terms? Okay? And this is where it gets really, and this is going to take 3 weeks. So if you're a coach and you're sitting here going, okay, get going, Troy. Come on. I can't do that, or otherwise I wouldn't be a really good teacher to you. Most of you would come here, even as a player, you'd be like, okay, just teach me to do this drill. Teach me new drills. That'll make me a lot better. It doesn't work that way. It doesn't work that way at all. Not in terms of making people. So these are terms, and then I'm asking you, raise your hand if you're a coach and you're a head coach or assistant. Raise your hand. You're an adult head coach or assistant or a college guy, okay. Quite a few, okay. Now, if you said, okay, I'm just going to do a brain dump of the way I speak. Forget it. MYA, you know, HA, they don't have a language. But you're going to have your own language for your team. And you just start writing down all the words that you know about the game. And then tell me if that's age appropriate to the age you're coaching. That's where you become a really good teacher. It's one of the first steps. Like, is this age appropriate? The way I see the game and the way I'm at my age and my experience, I don't know if this 13-year-old boy or girl really understands what I'm talking about. My wife is a guidance counselor, St. Croix Falls Middle School. She's a wonderful person. But she was doing a presentation last week, and I said, as a guidance counselor, I said, if you don't mind me asking, I'm just asking, have you given definition of what you're talking about last week? No, why? I said, because your audience is St. Croix Falls. You have no idea as a 53-year-old woman, like, if they even understand that, what you're talking about. You have to define it. We're going to talk about that tonight in a lot of ways. So as a good teacher, no matter where you're at in the world, you have to define it. But I'm saying these things would all mean something to me, potentially, but I don't know if I said that to the high school boys in town. If I said, hey, you know, do you know what toe caps and heels are? You know how I want you to understand it. All the high school players in the room might be like, I have no clue. to say that as a 60-year-old teacher, but until I define what I'm talking about, and before I understand the language I'm going to give you, I have to put arms and legs on that for you. I can't just say it, because that doesn't mean you're even going to understand it. Not only would I have to tell you what it is, I have to demonstrate what I'm asking you to do. Okay, so we have to understand the level we coach at versus the level of age I am as a teacher, the slash coach. I have to make things appropriate for my age level. So that's just something I would ask you to do on your own. Next page. So team and individual pyramids. This is just me. This would be me summarizing my career as a coach. Doesn't mean that it works for the people in the room. But if I was building a team and I wanted to give feedback to my team in a condensed, organized way all the time, wherever you are in your experience as a teacher or as a human being, you have to try and be consistent and non-emotional. But you need consistency. Repetition and consistency make you a good teacher. So whenever I address a team, which we'll get into, I usually wouldn't address them after the game anyway, no matter what I do as a coach. I've coached squirts, I wouldn't address them. I wouldn't talk to them, to be honest with you. I'd give them directions. Hey, we got another game today at 5 o'clock, I want you here at 4:15. Directional things I'd give them, but I wouldn't discuss the game. I haven't discussed it with myself. And if I just say what I'm thinking, I'm probably not always going to say that. Because we tend to look at things through that lens, more so than always positive, but I'm sure there's a lot of positive. But I would say, whatever I define as habits based on the age I'm coaching, I would look at that and go, where are habits going in the right direction? Because you have at least 2 days, hopefully a week of practice, your practice and your habits, so the kids should know what your habits are based on the age you're coaching. So I make a comment on how they're doing in the game with their habits. Then I talk about playing hard. How hard do we play relative to the age we are? And what is hard? Has it been determined? Has it even given a definition? Is what I expect hard at this level. Some checking, some non-checking, whatever. I'd give that a definition as to what I expect is hard, and I would address our firm play, or whatever you call it. Then I address smart. Well, I talk to you about smart all the time. We practice it, we talk about it, we talk about it before the game, we talk about it the day after the game. I would address the smart side. The beauty is, no matter what level you coach in here, if you play these two really well, regardless of what you do here, if you play these two very well, usually you're gonna win like 75% of the time. Is that easy? So if you feel like you're an adult here and you're passionate about your win-loss record, and that overrides some other factors you have while you're here coaching, no problem. But you're going to find your success rate will be based on these two things right here, most of the time, in the 70 percentile. It's that high, okay? Play as a team. What is play as a team? That's another whole part of being a good teacher, because that gets into life. That gets into, like, how you want to talk to kids, male or female players, like what time they get here, what it's like to be on a team, how do we play as a team, how are we classy after win or lose, how do we display ourselves, how do we handle ourselves. Then you have to address that. So I've always found that to be an off-ice issue as well as non-ice issue, but I like talking to my team about it because I think it develops good people. Okay. And then this was an old thing I had back up in the Western League that we just played for the Memorial Cup. But that was the pyramid. So if I came in the next day, I would just talk to our team about our pyramid. It would just be that simple. It'd be not a lot of anger. There wouldn't be any sarcasm. It would just be straightforward. Here's where we checked out. And this is the things I think you got to keep working on. So that was something I used just as a team pyramid. Go ahead and switch. Now, if you're in here and you're a teacher, coach, and you're an athlete, how do you develop a hockey player? This, in all my years of doing it, you know, which is a long time, this is the way to build a hockey player. The bottom part of the pyramid is no different than building a house. It's your foundation. It's the foundation of a hockey player. That's why it's on the bottom. The best thing we can do as a group in here together, whether you're a player or whether you're a coach and you're getting ready to teach for the winter, is you've got to address the mind. That's something that might be significantly different for some of you sitting here. A lot of times when you volunteer your time, I'm very appreciative of that, as is Stacy and everybody on the board. But the thing you want to do is just get right to drills, and you want to just think like out loud what I think we can do with this group. The realization is they're no different than the kids that are going to the schools in town. Like, you have to provide a base as a teacher, just like you're asking your teacher to do for your own son or daughter at school. Okay, it's the same. Everything kind of works the same. So I always dress the mind. That's emotion, that's everything else that goes into the whole thing. There's another whole slide of this that explains it, but I won't. The next one is body. Well, we look at, let's just address the high school guys in here. You know, if you go outside and you've got four bags of McDonald's in your car, you're probably not on a highway of greatness. That's just the reality of life. I get it. Sometimes it's what you've got to eat. I understand it. But it's probably not the way you want to live your life. It'd be a good athlete, okay? But your body, how you train, how you fuel it, how you hydrate it, how you get knowledgeable as a coach to how your kids hydrate, whether their own water bottles or whether you're bringing team water bottles to prevent sickness or to go on individual, whatever it may be. But the mind, the body is part of hydration and playing. The next one is skills. Now, if you take, let's just take Minnesota, where some of you probably have taken your kids and you've either went over now to VSA, over in Eau Claire, Chippewa, or you go into MAP, you know, MAP South, or wherever you go to say, I want to take my son or daughter here to train, okay? A lot of places we go is all based on skill development. But now, what is skill development? We're going to get into that. That's going to be a big part of what you want to understand is if I'm a teacher and I'm coaching, what is skill? Like, how am I teaching it? How do I see it? How do I put it forth? This part here is a lost art in coaching. This is something that most organizations, he mentioned New Richmond. When I got with New Richmond, they had no idea what tactics were. And that's why they were a mess. Just that alone. They didn't understand tactics. They didn't know how to teach it. They just went right from skills right to systems. I'm like, systems? How do you have systems for a 12-year-old? How the heck are you teaching a system? Like, they barely can chew and wind their watch, let alone play a system. Like, I got pro guys that can't play systems. So you have to understand what tactics are. The simplest definition I can give you is it's numbers and colors. There's two colors on the ice, it's numbers. Basketball and hockey are the same games. 3-on-2, it's 1-on-1, it's 2-on-1, it's 2-on-3, it's 5-on-5, it's 6-on-5, it's 5-on-4, it's 4-on-5. That's tactics. You have to be able to teach tactical play in order to have good system play. So if you're coaching a Bantam team in here, raise your hand. Okay? If you have your Bantam coaches, you can get away with some system stuff to some degree, probably, right? Is that fair? Okay. What would make your systems unbelievable is your ability to teach tactics. Once your tactics are in play, then systems take care of itself. If you're a high school player in here, and your coaches are here, and you're learning, you want to understand how tactics work. How do I defend a 2-on-1, which is really a 2-on-2 with the goalie, but how do we factor the goalie into a 2-on-1, and I use it as a 2-on-2 mass situation? Once you start to understand that as a player, then the game becomes way easier. It doesn't matter what head coach in here says, what the system is. I already understand the tactical play within the system. Does this make sense? Okay?
Yes.
Thank you. So we're getting there. So you're going to process that over time. What will put arms and legs on it for you is when I show you, like, next Monday or something, I start to get into, let's talk about a 2-on-1 and let's look at it offensively. And I'll say, okay, here's what I would be teaching a 2-on offensively. Here's where you buy your time and space. Here's how your inside edges work. Here's where you want to slow down. Here's where your brain engages with the legs and the hands. These are things you're trying to teach the kids. Once you start to be able to teach like that, then whatever, as you grow them through your organization here, when they get to the Bantam level, high school level, systems make total sense. But you got to get the tactics right, okay? Then system play. Eventually, some of you will be in the strategy here, and eventually, as an individual player, then you get into games. If you set strategy alone, the biggest thing I would say, just so I don't forget it, like, in the next couple of weeks, but I probably won't, but strategy is basically, who's the best coach in the world? Trick question. Who's the best coach in the world? Does just for laughs. Huh?
The game.
The game. Good answer. Not the correct one, but I'll take it. Pardon me? You're the best. I'm bringing you a prize next week. Don't miss. No.
The parent in the stands.
True story. The clock. The clock. The clock is the best game. It's the best coach in the world. Always has been, always will be. So young players, you got to know what type of decision to make based on the score, the period, the time on the clock. It's no different than life. Does anything good happen after midnight in Menominee? Not really. Okay, so you got to know the clock. You got to know the stars, the moon, the sun. It's just real simple. It's not real rocket science stuff, but strategy-wise, the clock is the best teacher. That gets into a lot of strategies. Because when you get into strategies, you're like, when do we pull our goal? When do we do this? When do we do this? When do we do that? Well, it's based on everything that the clock's done. It's basically how you use the clock at a higher level. So next one. So those are two things. Now, this will be provided for you, so I'm not going to spend time reading all that, but I've just basically answered in there everything you're thinking about. So that's the next page. So a lot of you head coaches, you have that already, but that's basically broken down. The only thing I would say, the tactical system that I think we're going to get into today a little bit, term most often used when talking about this area, is hockey sense, which we're going to get into a lot. Because that's a big topic of being a good teacher. So that would be provided for you in the packet. We'll get into that more. Go ahead. Okay, so let's just put arms and legs on hockey sense. I'll give you an experienced definition of it that we'll talk about. Okay, so hockey sense is a player with elite hockey sense, understands the whole game, not just the part of it. High school kids, raise your hand if you're a forward. Okay, perfect. Raise your hand as a D. Perfect. Where's my goals? Okay? Everybody should be able to play everybody's position if you've got a high, high level of hockey IQ. So a coach could say, first name goalie?
Jack.
Jack. Jack, you're going to play D tonight? Good. No problem. You understand the dots. You understand the lines. You understand how to play. You know when to pressure, when not to pressure. You jump right out in there. You might not skate as well as everybody else, but you know what to do. That gives you a chance. That's your hockey IQ. If I take a D and I move to forward and vice versa, and they can play and they can operate the game and think, they've got elite hockey sense. So you got to understand the game and just not your part in it. So he or she has a feel of what should be happening in all areas of the ice, enabling him to understand what the other players will be doing. This is wired into how he plays the game. It doesn't fluctuate based on pressure or circumstance. So as the game changes and the clock changes and the score and how much time is left, as that thing changes, as the teacher, the good elite player does not fluctuate from playing their game. Not at all. They're very calm. They're very, very intelligent. Our best state representative of hockey sense is Joel Pavelski. Hands down, not even close. No disrespect to any other Wisconsin player. It's not even close. He's an elite, elite class of hockey IQ because he can't skate across this rink. He's a poor skater. But the beauty is he's such a poor skater. His hockey IQ is so high, he understands where to arrive and what time to get there. That's hockey sense. Okay, he knows how to get into traffic and how to get out. So his brain functions at a really high level. Even at his age right now, having one of his career years last year, he's not getting faster, you know. He's getting slower, but he's elite brain. Okay? So indicators, forwards, insert yourself, herself into the game every shift. Defenseman, it's called you're sorting things out in the neutral. So an example for you as teachers, as coaches, how does my defenseman sort out the other team's attack? Are they processing this? Are they doing what I'm asking them to do? If they can do that at a high speed, whether it's your drills or games, that person probably has pretty good hockey IQ. If you said, a defenseman, he inserts himself or herself basically into every shift. And usually what that happens with high hockey IQ people is once they climb over the boards on a line of change, the play is going through them within 7 seconds. Players with no hockey sense will be away from the puck for as many as 10 to 15 seconds. They'll just be going over the boards trying to figure out this game and where everybody's going, and man, they're going really fast for me. And I'm not sure how to get involved. So they kind of just sit back. That's because their hockey IQ isn't very good. People that get over the boards and jump right into the fray, and they're into the mix, they've got a pretty good feel for what's happening, and they have an understanding of what's expected. Youth coaches in here, focus, intensity, consistency, ability to adapt and change. This is where you as a teacher, you have to see this. You gotta focus on, okay, which players on my team really have good hockey sense. And when I explain a drill, man, they're really focused. When I explain what we're doing at the whiteboard or however I diagram it, they always end up at the front of the line and they always do it right. They're probably high hockey IQ. They want to get going because they also understand if I get to the front line, I get more reps than everybody else. I get better. So the brain just functions at that level. Intensity, consistency, we'll get into this more. Next page. Now we get into character. This is like, and this is, I'm getting into this stuff also because I'm trying to teach you like how I have to work when I was a pro scout for Vancouver. Okay, so when I wore this stuff, when I was doing this for Vancouver, first thing we had to figure out is hockey IQ as a scout. Okay, so for you as high school players, and you're saying, hey, through my coaches, I might get to a point where I want to go to a junior camp or I want to go. How would you be identified first for this to be beneficial for you? First thing they're going to look at is your hockey IQ, your hockey sense, how smart you are. That puts you in the game. The next part, which is really going to put you in the game, is a player with elite character feels personally responsible for the team results no matter what that result is or no matter what the role is. So now all of you as coaches, when we put a definition to character as you become teachers, this is a big part of going back to pyramid and teaching kids. That's why I'm giving it to you, but I'm also giving you a definition. Think about this right now, and think about your coaching the last year. If you're a college guy in here, and you're playing at the college level, does this define who you are? Because if it does, and you're sitting here, your character is really high. Your character is elite. In fact, it's really high. But as a bunch of teachers in the room and as a bunch of players, we oftentimes don't look at life or the game this way. We usually, because life can be really easy to go negative, we go down a bad path. But now, I'm giving it back to you is, now you're the teacher, you have to curb this through your mannerisms and how you look at your team and how you address your team. When you address your team, and do you address character? And if you do, then it's going to make your coaching a lot easier. So when you get into systems, tactical play, skill work, and all that, if you determine what character is and how you want them to behave in this situation, no different than getting on the bus and going to school and what their behavior is in that classroom, it becomes a lot easier. The unfortunate part is usually as a bunch of volunteer people, because we love the game or we love giving back to our community or maybe we have a daughter or son playing in the organization, we oftentimes don't think this way. There's nothing wrong with that. There's nothing wrong with whatever you've done. But I'm telling you, if you spend more time on this stuff, the actual doing the drills is way easier. And the performance will get way better because you've started to identify how we're going to act and how we're going to behave. The indicators are internal versus external. So what does that mean? I'll give you the basic, simple explanation of that. Hockey players that have internal fuel, it's their wiring, it's their abdomen. You're sitting in the room, it's just the way you feel. It's just great. That's internal fuel. You have internal fuel not to be denied. External fuel is, I'm sure it happens in every game, is a parent paying their son or daughter for the goals they score. That's external fuel. That's external fuel. That doesn't work in the end. It doesn't work. There's nothing maybe you can do it at the moment as a coach sitting here. But it oftentimes never works. It fails eventually. It works part-time and it never works long-term. So Players that perform a certain way based on their internal standards and character, the way they are wired, rather than external stimuli, such as I call it a control level, contract status, ice time, lag days, whether the coach likes it, etc. And then the next part about elite character is, does the player take battles personally and exhibit courage and discipline going into the hard areas of the ice? That's a very high end. You would say that that doesn't apply here, but I need to give it to you as a teacher, okay? So when you have a little boy in town or a little girl or you're a high school player and you go into a physical battle, and you and I, your first name is Wayne. Wayne. Wayne and I go into a personal battle for the puck, and I lose the puck battle. My body language to you guys as a group of men and women that are teachers in the room, you should know my wiring. You should sense it, you should feel it. If it matters to me, there's gonna be some disappointment. You will have disappointment, but it might not be displayed as a group of teachers, coaches that you like. That's when you become a good teacher and a coach. It's like, I get it, I'll use Wayne. I get it, Wayne, you didn't like it, and you did X and you came back to the bench, but we've got to eliminate X over time. I felt it. I know you don't like to lose your puck guys. But we also have the character and all these other things that are a part of our development here for your short-term and long-term within our organization. So I got to now become a really good teacher in how they display that. But I'll know, or I can sense, even if I come into town a month from now, I can watch right through here, and I'll be able to know the wiring of players and whether they're wired in that, and they take battles personally. You'll see it. Now, to become special, and you say, okay, Troy talked about smart and hard, we do both. We don't take a lot of penalties, but our kids play very, really hard. They compete within the rules, whistle to whistle. You're, like I said, you're going to win a lot. But then just you understanding and teaching what hard is and how you want them to play within their age bracket is really critical. Okay? So that's an example of, does the player take battles personally? We'll get more into that in the next few weeks and a little bit more maybe tonight. Go ahead, next week. Players with elite skill can buy time with the puck, execute the traffic, and still making plays while absorbing pressure or contact. That is skill. That is probably not, no disrespect, but just say it openly, it's probably not our evaluation of what skill is here. It's okay. It's okay. But I'm going to give you a different way to think. What you choose to do as coaches, that's the beauty of coaching. You do what you think is right for you. I'm not here to change your whole world and flip you upside down. I'm here to give you suggestions and help. You decide what you take for that. But when you talk about skill in today's game, it's your player's ability to play in traffic, period. It is not top of circle to top of circle, how good you look if you can make a saucer pass. That is not skill. That is an everyday player in today's world. Some of you dads that are my age, you're like, well, that was skill at my age. Yeah, you're right, it was. It's not now. It's just not. So I have to absorb contact from Wayne. I have to get hit. I have to hold the puck, I got to stay over it, I got to spin off the contact, use the contact as a momentum for me to get away and separate, get my eyes and make the play. That's what skill is, ultimately, when you're teaching skill. Okay, that's what it really is. Now, can you do that if you're at the U10 or U12 level or whatever it is? Not really, because of the rules. But if you have an understanding of it, it's going to make you way better, because now you might do drills example much different. So instead of saying, we're going to work on stick handling, and I'm going to blow the whistle, and from the two corners here, we got two lines, both one at the same time, we got three kids going out in each corner, and we're giving you, we got a half ice practice, but we're just going to give you from the goal line to the blue line, go ahead and stick handle all six of you at one whistle, we're going to work on your skill in stick handling and vision. Okay? That's a way to look at it. But then if you start to understand skill a little differently, really what it is, you say, no, let's let those three go inside that circle and let those three go inside that circle, and my let's see the stick handle inside the circle can find their area. Now you're getting more into a skilled situation by just changing the size of what the position you gave to work with. Does that make sense? But if you don't think that way, that's okay. But now it's like, oh, okay, I start to understand what skill is. All right, so Now we get into, which is the big term, I don't know what it's like here in town, but hard skill versus soft skill. Soft skill is something that is a necessary evil with a lot of teams. If you talked about the NHL to college into junior where I'm at, like for example in Sioux City this year, we might have one kind of soft skill guy that I could take. The rest I need all hard skill. Soft skill I don't need. Soft skill is reachers, pokers, hopers, soft skill to reach, poke. That they might say that they're skilled, they want to take pucks away from people, but they really don't. They need time and space all the time to make plays. There's nothing wrong with it. I'm here to teach you that. You can have soft skill players here, you can develop soft skill players. If they're elite, they will make it on the teams as they go. But then they have to become really elite. Okay? Back in my era of coaching the Badgers, 2001 to 2005, anybody remember that era? 2006, we won it. I recruited that whole team. Remember Robbie Earl?
Hollywood.
Soft skill. He's like a son to me. He's lived with me. Like I love him. The highest he ever got was a little bit of a cup of coffee with the Minnesota Wild and a couple games with the Toronto Maple Leafs. That was it. The reason why? Wonderful skater, wonderful human being, good player, awesome speed, but had soft skill. So he couldn't climb the ladder as he got older because he had too much soft skill in him and no heart. He wanted to reach for pucks, poke, play that way. So he ended up playing in Europe, ended up playing. Nothing wrong with what he did. I'm all for him. Like a son to me. Love him to death. But he was a soft skilled example player. Joe Pavelski, same era, can't skate, hard skill. Joe Pavelski's going to stick his hips into you. He's going to take his bottom hand of his stick. He's going to drive into you with that bottom hand, and he's going to have huge bite. He just doesn't skate that well, but he's hard skilled. Okay, so there's a difference in why there one plays up and why that one doesn't. So that's, can you execute tough areas of the rank? Their ability to execute is not limited to open ice situations. They don't feel a need to immediately relinquish the puck. So that's a hard skill player, okay? They don't want to give up the puck very often. Those of you high school players, I should say this to you, if you're developing this year, you want to be a better player, you want to be a good player, get to hard skill ASAP. See your coaches because you're going to want to possess. It'll be the most noticeable thing I can say to you when I come and watch you play as a scout. Do you want it? If you want it, do you go get it? How long can you keep it? That's hard skill. I know you want it, but then if you can't keep it very long, then I know you're soft skill. Because as soon as it gets tough and contact happens, you don't have the puck that long. So as teachers, we might be doing some things where now we do skill work, and I put you inside that circle now, and I say with my Bantam coaches, let's get hips, let's get bottom hands, and let's get competing, and you got to manage your puck within the circle by not letting anybody else poke the puck off their stick, and they got to keep their puck in the circle where everybody else is trying to knock theirs out. Person that wins, you'll start to see and they'll start to understand this is hard skill. If we just stick handle around with open ice and just free flowing, you're just producing just good skill development to a certain extent, but when the game happens, there's two colors and there's not a lot of time and space. And if you want your team to have it, you gotta work on that part of the component of being a good teacher. So that's why we just determined that way. Next one. Skill areas. So then I just put these down for you to, I put these marks on your paper so you could work on it as a working apparatus, but this is what your terms would be. What are your skilled areas? How do you speak? I go back to how what you think of what your terms would be. Feathering, small dribble outside the shoulders, fakes, puck protection, soft hand vision, vision 530, 630. I'll give you an example of that. But that's where, like, to be a good teacher, the goal is work on your plan. Start to go, okay, this is the way I communicate, this is the way I talk, this is the way I see the game. Not sure I believe in what Troy said, but I'm going to leave it over here and I'm trying to grow and get better. But this is the way I would speak. So then I'm constantly repeating what I say over and over. Repetition is the best teacher. Then it becomes very easy. But you need to spend time on that. I realize that you're a volunteer. I understand. The vision part is like 5:30 and 6:30. So when you teach vision to a hockey player and the puck is in front of me, most of the people at your age, let's say if you're, let's say under, we'll just make, say it's 12. Most of those kids under 12 can use it as a clock, and straight in front of me is noon. They can see 1 and 11. That's about it. So as they play, they might see 1 and 11. Your youngest kids can see noon. They can see straight ahead. That's it. Okay, that's all they can see. Okay, no problem. But that gives you a better perspective as to how you now teach the game at your age-appropriate level, no matter what you're teaching, because you're asking them to do things or share the puck. But, well, how old are my kids? I really don't know if they can see that. I think they should be able to, but they can't. A high school player in the state of Wisconsin usually is at like 2:30 and 9:30. Team Wisconsin, I watched Saturday, played 2 games over in Minnesota in the High School Elite League. The best players on Team Wisconsin this year, there's a few that can maybe see 3 o'clock and 9 o'clock as they play. So they can see to the sides. They can kind of see everything that's going on to the sides. If you definitionally go really fast, who can see 6 p.m.? Very, very few players. One that would come to mind would be Datsun. He's now not here anymore. That guy can see exactly behind the set. There's a few other ones, but most of the elite players in the NHL are like 5:30 and 6:30, 5 and 7, where they just see all of this stuff here. But there isn't a lot. So when you look at teaching vision and you teach skill and you're working on skill areas, you have to understand that whatever I'm asking my team to do or this particular player, what is his age and what do I really think he can see? Then we get to the simple terminology. Why is it we have to wait till college hockey or the NHL? Part of its budget, I get it. But why do the socks match the jerseys in college, in practice, and in pro? Because those players can't even get their head up. That's why the socks match the jersey. It's that simple. But here we're going to show up and there'll be 2 different color socks, a different color jersey, and then you're, I'm mad at, is it Wayne? I'm all pissed off at Wayne if I can say that. Jesus, Wayne, what are you doing? How the hell can't you see that? Whatever my verbiage is, and Wayne's like, dude, I'm 12. Like, you want to try to be in my shoes? Like, I can't see that. I can't get my eyes up long enough to see where I'm going or who I'm giving it to. So it changes our pace, if you would, as a teacher. It changes our patient level as to what I have to do and how my verbiage comes out. So that's the visionary and skill part. Giving you a little bit there, go ahead, Terry. Thank you. Skill area turns to passing, hard, side to side, up and down. You use your 1 through 6, whatever you think. Cycle, drop, one touch, go ahead, Terry. That's the numbers for you. Skill area terms and shooting, again, age appropriate. What do you talk about? What age are you coaching? What do you talk about? Like, are you actually into one-timers and you're a U-12 coach? Because you were the best phenomenon guy that ever played for Terry Watkins in 1989. And you can one-time it, but now you want kids to one-time it because you can do it? Well, that might not be age appropriate. So I don't know what your terms are. Go ahead, Terry. I am giving you that. Skating. Here's where you go. Here's the interesting part about skating across the world. Those of you, how many feel in here, raise your hands, coach, can teach skating fairly well based on your past, okay? All right, good. Now, in terms of what we look at in terms of college, when I go project the player as a college coach or I do it as a pro scout in the NHL, it's all by position. The good news is high school players are getting evaluated based on your position with your ability to skate. Back when me and Wayne played, for sure me, no disrespect, I'm not trying to be a chip on that. It wasn't that way. We were just all lumped into one. We were all just lumped into one. Now it's skating specific. So, you know, when you get into skating, the indicators is the skating a problem as a result of a stride flaw, or could it be just a result of physical weakness? This would be hard for you, I think, as a volunteer coach. You're now looking at your players and you're trying to sit back as a teacher and you're evaluating my overall team skating. It's my first practice. I'm looking at my group. I'm just trying to talk to my assistant Terry and they're like, what kind of skaters do we have? And we're just sitting back running some skating drills and you're trying to assess that. But you don't have a lot of experience yet as a teacher, but then you would say to yourself, is it a stride flaw or do you think that just because of the age we're at, they're just physically weak, but they do have a nice draw. I like their extension, I like their recovery, their covers underneath, I like their knee bend, all those things. You can tell that. Once get educated, you can see. That will then help change the way maybe you're skating the beginning of practice and how you teach it. Acceleration and torque, ability to move quickly in tight areas versus overall speed, balance and strength for the feet, ability to change direction. These are all indicators. So that's really what it is. So the high school kids in here, if you're trying out for teams in the summer and you're a defenseman, you're really going to be held accountable in your pivots. Forwards, you're going to be really accountable in the transition game and how you can transition back and forth. It's really going to be critical and to face the puck all the time. Go ahead and carry. So that's the skating part. Now we're getting into system stuff. So I'm going to go through this, but Terry, let's go through this for the next slide. Defense, offense, go to the next slide. So what I do as a teacher, and this will come up in a slide better to make this more sense, but what I like to do as a teacher is, how many of you can only talk, well, you talk after the first and after the second, but the age you're coaching in here, you only have one Zach, or you have none. Raise your hand, none or one. Okay, so a lot of you don't, you're just on the bench, right? You never leave the bench, and now you're sitting there and you're looking at all your kids and you're like, you've got to say something. This is your moment to address the team. So then, think of, as an adult, think of how you talk normally every day, as of now not being a teacher in the bench, but think of how you talk, and then how you process information, and whether you, how you're feeling about the first period. Then you go and say, I really want to talk about breakup, but because Johnny and Joey are talking, or they're not really paying attention visually at that time, they miss the whole world. They just miss breakup. So then, as a teacher, when I was learning, I thought, well, I don't have time to write the word breakout, even if I'm a pro coach. I'm not going to go in to write the word breakout and then start to discuss it. It takes way too long. So I just came up with my own system language. And basically, I just go and I just write BO on the whiteboard. And all the brains attach right to breakout. They know I'm going to talk about breakout. I don't have to write anything else. Their brain attaches to what I want them to understand about what we have to either continue to do or make some adjustments in when we go to breakout. So all of these things have offensive terminology and defensive terminology, which will make sense in the ones coming up. When I always talk about the game, me personally, as a teacher to you, you don't have to do what I do. But I put things in terms of math, because the best players you have, no matter what your age is, it's a math game to them. The best players look at it as math. So if I said to the college guys, which are over here, there's a few of them, I say, oh, we're going to work on we're going to work on the power play. One of those high-functioning brains would be like, which one? 5-on-3 or 5-on-4? Who do we work on? Because how I play this and what the time and the difference is makes a big deal to me. So what do you want me to attach to? So I don't like the word breakout personally as a teacher because it's too open-ended. I want specific. If I want the 5-3, I'm going to write up a board. We're working on the 5-3. They already attached. All right, this is great. This is like one tease. We're shooting. We got time and space. So I speak in terms of math because I think it attaches players quicker and it's easier for me than writing the word power play. I just put down which power play I'm working. Then these are the face-offs. Who's this? Face-off offensive zone, face-off neutral zone, face-off diesel. It's just really quick. If I want to talk about a face-off, that's all I write down. The brain attaches to what I've given them the terminology to start the season. I've defined it in writing, and now I just do it. Coaches, language, or bench, no vision. So then you have to do all this. So next page. Next page. So here's offensive teaching. And how you teach ultimately is how you read a book. Those of you that are in here, I know that a lot of you won't have video. You might have the odd iPad video thing of how you lay out your teaching. But if you're a peer teacher in the game, and you're in between periods or after the game, even as a college coach, a high school coach, a band coach, whatever, and you just start to go, we're going to work on the 5-on-4, then we're going to look at some defensive zone coverage, and then the LRF, and then ICO. The kids are like, whoa, dude, easy. Can you take me back to the start? So you want to know how to lay it out as a teacher, teach it like you read a book. So basically, get out there and say, we're going to start with the puck at our exits because that determines what we do out here. So I'm going to teach breakout. I maybe have 1 point in bonds. I maybe have no points in the LRF. And I have patio. I just took my team right down the ice. They'll totally follow me. They'll totally be like, thank you very much. That's how I play. Now they understand as a teacher. Or they understand you as a teacher. When I grew up learning the game as a high school player, I thought the red line determined whether it was on offense or defense. Almost all the way through college. Right down the road. Wally Ackman just went into the Wisconsin Hall of Fame on Saturday. Bless his heart. Good man. Deserves to be in. Got inducted on Saturday. He learned. He didn't even teach Stella. He's in the Hall of Fame. He's a good man. Good coach back in the day. But we don't understand the way to teach the game. If we have the puck in the room as a group, we are on offense. It doesn't matter what zone it's in. So when you look at teaching hockey IQ and you teach your team to be better, they have to move and operate when your team has the puck to understand how to play. Most of our children, maybe some sitting in the room, think that if I cross the red line, I'm on offense. If I go back the other way, I'm on defense. Couldn't be any more than farthest thing from the truth. So you'll notice teams that you're going to start to play this year. Let's click on Eau Claire. Pick on. You play an Eau Claire and you're like, ooh, we're just like zipping up and down the ice pass. They won't know because they have not been taught that they're in their end and they think they're in D zone coverage. So the brains of all the players away from the puck, they all think they're in coverage. So when their teammates gets it, they don't know how to get to space. They don't know which space to go to because they haven't been drilled it and they haven't been taught it. So they sit in their D zone forever. Because their brain doesn't function that they're on offense. My teammate has the puck, but I'm just sitting here thinking I'm covering my point. Does this make sense? Okay, so when we talk about our offensive systems, there's four. I just, again, these are now words. These are the breakdown of what I would write on the board in terms of offense. Okay, switch it over. Now this is the defense. So forecheck is forecheck. Okay, that's, we don't have the puck. We dumped it in. We're trying to get the puck back. So are we a 1-2-2 team? Are we a 2-1-2 team? What's the map of our forecheck? How are we forechecking? Have you even told me what the forecheck number system is? Or there is no system because you don't believe in it. Well, then teach me what you want me to do on the forecheck. That's for you to determine. Now we've taught the team how to come down the ice as a group of teachers. Now we're going to teach the team how you go back. And if you lay the video or the teaching in between periods this way all the time with some organizational thought process, you'll be amazed how quickly your kids get. By Thanksgiving this year, even though this would be tough, according to Adam Thielen, okay? Even according to him, I'm telling you by Thanksgiving, or just after, your kids will be processing way quicker. The game is played like this. Offense, defense, 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 offense, defense, defense, offense, defense, defense. That's what we're trying to teach. No matter what the skill level is, you could say that they're not moving at that pace, but their brain's moving at that pace. They just don't know what the hell to do. They don't know if we're on offense or defense. They can't process it. But once you teach this and you get this laid out with some language to it, whatever your language is, that's up to the board and the people in the room. You don't have to use what I'm using. But you do have to come up with four different styles of how you see the game offensively and four different acronyms of how you see the game defensively. There are going to be a lot of coaches in here. There's no way you would ever teach forecheck neutral. You're coaching two young kids. It's not a system, and there wouldn't even be a tackle. But I tell you what you can teach is how do you come back into your own end? Do you want them outside the dots? That's like not locking your front door. Don't make sense. So then you'd say, well, I really don't teach how to back check here at forecheck neutral zone, but I can tell you this, all our kids will skate wherever you are on the ice. Wherever we lose the puck, we want you to go here and straight down the middle and all arrive right here. If we have more numbers here than Eau Claire, we're probably going to be okay. If we all come back here with no system stuff at U12 and we just go and back check here and this guy back checks here and this one's super slow and he gets in late, well, the middle is wide open. Well, the team that has more colors in the middle wins. Doesn't matter just which end you want to have more colors. Well, defensively, if you could just teach that part of it, understanding you can't teach a forecheck to lose owner, maybe you can't say LRA, but you now understand the difference, the game difference, when you bring them back the right way, you're probably going to have a better team. Easy. By early December, Thanksgiving, just now gets down to your drills.
It's a common language, too. That's one of the things that with our group here is that as the kids learn, you know, defensive zone cover, line rush against, forecheck, moving zone, forecheck. You know, as we add drills, you know, it applies to a certain area, and yes, we're on offense, we're on defense. And I think the consistency, and that's what we're lacking, we don't have consistency from sports views to them. If the kids learn this at sports views, all of a sudden, you know, we expand on what you grow up. I mean, this to me is a basis for what we need to do today.
It is a basis. It's a matter of just whatever terminology you want to use, quite frankly. Don't have to adapt.
And I think you apply, and you correct me here, but I think, you know, when we work on drills and practice, we apply that drill to this area. We have a lot of half-life practices, okay, with defensive zone cover. Okay, this is what we're doing, you know, or neutral zone, line rush against, maybe a half-ice or whatever. And the drills relate to this.
So it's like when we, this is a little bit further down than I want to be, but let's just talk about arrival. So when you have even the high school kids, okay, so when you arrive into the D-zone coverage and you're playing Eau Claire North this year, you arrive in D-zone coverage, then we get your brain into what we call sort out. Now your brain has to function as to where to go based on what the coach told you and how quickly can you get there. But your brain is in sort out. The more I can get you to the right position to make you calm and in a position to at least defend and then sort out from there, the better off our team is. So a lot of people will in here as teachers in the past or still to this point, you'll teach D-zone coverage. But then you'll be like, man, you're just terrible at D-zone coverage. Well, then I would say as a teacher, well, what part of your D-zone coverage is bad? The first 15 seconds? Or does it eventually sort itself out and gets okay once the puck gets in the corners? Usually when things go bad right away as a teacher and a coach, it's usually right away because your athletes are all trying to sort out where to go and how quickly to get there. Then they have to factor in their stick position. They have to factor in all these other things, not to mention look at mom and dad and wave and do all the other things you're trying to figure out. Right? So it's like there's a lot to sort out. That's why I'm saying we're going to help you with that in the next couple of weeks. Go ahead, next year. So pregame. Now I'm just kind of taking you through a real quick synopsis as a teacher. Go ahead. Whiteboard notes differ from our pregame language speech most of the time, tactical assistance. So this is where it gets really confusing. Okay, and I'm just helping you. You're going to teach during the week. You've got a busy day at work. You're a little bit behind. Let's call a spade. You show up. You're like, well, what are we doing? You look at your assistant. You're like, well, I got a couple of drills. I got a couple of drills. Woo! Pretty soon you know it. You're 50 minutes in. You're 50-minute practice or your hour practice, and you're like, ooh. Not sure what we got done, but the way we usually talk differs than the way we talk before the game. Because we're trying to play catch up on the ice. Because we got here late from work, I've had a busy day, I've had a proper time to prepare. I get it. It's hard. I'm with you, not against you. But then in your language and everything changes. And it doesn't work. Like these high school kids in here, they're really smart. They're not.
You don't know.
They're smart, so they understand. College guys, they understand. Youth kids, they understand. Like, they're smart. So the consistency of how when I write on the whiteboard is how I speak makes a big difference. I can't be an adult coming from work and speak one way and then get out there with U12 kids and speak the same way I spoke to the people at work all day. It doesn't work. It's going to make it really tough for you to be a good teacher and have success. Next one. So I'm just helping you with the honesty approach. I hope you can just take it. The whiteboard is prepared 2 hours prior to players' arrival. So I'm just giving the example. At a high level, college, junior, right now at the level I'm at, pro, there are always you guys would be as high school players, you'd be at the rink 2 hours before. I get that you're youth coaches. I know they're not there 2 hours before. I'm just using this as an example, okay? But the whiteboard is already prepared before the players get there. Highest level 2 hours before, because everybody gets there at different times as you get older. They all have different routines. These high school kids have different routines. Some of the kids were parked in their cars out here today at quarter to six. And And some of you showed up at 6:20. Right? That's fine. But all of you need to get where you need to go to based on process what I need to know and feel comfortable to be in that meeting or feel comfortable while playing. Well, the same thing here. If I'm a youth coach and I've got something to say, I might, as a teacher, I might just put a little whiteboard or my ring diagram board in the locker room so when they get there, they can just read what I'm going to talk about. Or I might take a sheet up on the wall. Like, this is what I'm going to talk about. They can read it a little bit, depending on the age you're coaching, and then they have an idea what you're going to talk about. So the comprehension starts. So you have to kind of get organized. My end point, go ahead, next point, before you teach. And it can be delivered many different ways. It can be X's and O's. It can be bullet points. It can be through your assistant coach. We get it in many different ways. We'll talk about over time. Go ahead. You as a youth coach can use other methods in the locker room. You can use whatever you want. But there's really good youth coaches that are really organized, and they really are really effective teachers before the game. The result is really not the end all. It's more about the teaching. So the result gets better and better. This is the way to do it. So pregame at a junior level, if you take the Sioux City Musketeers versus the Madison Capitals in their appropriate colors, and you teach breakout, TWG, at that, in my language, means take what's given. So I just say, well, this is the beauty of being a good teacher. Now, a lot of your youth coaches, so keep this, I'm just educating you. Again, I don't expect you to do this, and I don't think it's possible, but I want to educate you as to how you can look at yourself as you mature as a teacher. If I teach the breakout here, I want my kids at level for over here for high school or junior college. I want them to know what the other team is doing. So how we break out is based on that these plays, they play a 1-2-2. They take away the strong side, not overly physical, and D will pinch on rims. So I've told my high school and junior group this is the way it's going to happen. On the other side of it, I've said, this is what Madison's going to do, and here's what we need to do to be successful. So now their brain attaches, going back to the verbiage. They're like, okay, Coach Ward is going to talk about breakouts tonight. But yet, what's Madison doing? Oh, I read the sheet. They're a 1-2-2 team, so we have time and space. He told us we have time and space. They will pinch on rims. Okay, so I got to be ready for that. He's already pretty much told me what's going to happen in the game. He just asked me to read it so that I could be more prepared and make better decisions. But they go hand in hand. So if you're teaching the forecheck, then you teach the musketeer to break it. Does that make sense? You just flip it, and that's how you lay it out as a teacher so that your kids or players, they understand what the opponent is going to do and what we want to do to be successful. But that's where the system stuff becomes really, really critical. But I don't want you to go on systems. Just think of tactics. Just think, well, hey, how are we going to get out? I'm a U-12 coach. How do we break out? Most teams that we play will always come into the zone with this posture, whatever that posture is to you as a teacher, as a coach. Well, what we have to do is we just have to know three principles. That's all we have to do at this level this year. If we get these three things done tactically, we're probably going to get out against 75 or 80% of everybody we play, if we can execute. Okay, so then you understand. So I want your brain to go from, yes, I'm teaching offense, but as I mature and develop as a good teacher, I understand what the other team is doing defensively. I still want to focus just on my team, but yet I have some awareness of why we would have trouble. This is the things that this Eau Claire team does that makes it difficult for us. Okay? If that makes sense. So it's the same in these other systems. Go ahead, Terry. Thanks. Go ahead. Go ahead, this is the player time, reminders, go ahead, changes, go ahead, language abbreviations, 3-4 minutes of length, 18 minutes intermission. So this part here is all based on like higher level. I'm just giving you higher level, okay, just for an example. I don't want you to follow this, but this is the player's time. So a lot of times as you get older, you high school guys, and that we have to allow for just your time. We have to, even as a teacher. I'm really supposed to teach Monday through Friday. Saturday and Sunday as a youth coach, I really am the fruits of my teaching. It's a test. If I've been a good teacher, we should be okay. I don't have to overteach. But I've been a really good teacher. this information so they think I'm smart. Less is more. So you just get in some periods and you just let people be people and let them just have their own time. You might give them some reminders after the verse. You might make a subtle change that will take 10 seconds to say. But basically, you might get into this stuff as you go. But if you get to the pro level, I would have as a pro coach, when I was a pro coach, 3 minutes and 18 minute intermission. That's all I got. 3 minutes, my system is like, you're out. I give them anything more than that, it's not good. The retention is like really low, under 25%. So I have 3 minutes, that's it. And I better have my 3 minutes really organized. So I can't cover every problem we have in every system. It's impossible. I have to pick out as a teacher what isn't going so well and what do I think is going to be the best changes we need to make to have some success and feel good about ourselves. Regardless of, I think winning is a matters at all, but to have some success and have the kids enjoy it, we have to get out of our end, so I really have to work out the breakout. That's it. We'll see what happens in the offensive zone, but I'm not into that. So coaches, go ahead and take Terry. Head coach with the forwards and assistants, with the defensive goalie, go ahead. Depends on use of whiteboards, two colors if possible, repetition of language, the back corner, please. Thank you, thank you. So use of whiteboards, two colors if possible. What does that mean? Pardon me?
Two-colored markers.
Two-colored markers. What does X-Batch have? Black and white? You guys operate in a black and white world? So if you're going to be an effective teacher, you can actually hold a red pen and a black pen in your hands and write easily on the whiteboard at once. So if I'm doing a drill and I want my kids to retain it and I want them to play, do the drill right, I'll show the offensive part of the drill in red, and if I have any defensive component, I'll draw it black. Because they'll retain it, like there's no tomorrow. If you don't and you haven't, I'm okay with that. Just be open-minded. I always ask my teams for two things. Always. Two things my whole career. One, be open-minded to change. And two, have a sense of humor. And we'll get along very good. And this will be an easy 9 months. But you better be open-minded to change, and it goes both ways. I have to adapt to what you can give, and I gotta accept that. You also have to adapt how you play within the framework of our team and how I can help you as an individual. So there's gonna be change. So I'm asking you just to consider change as a coach. The more you can write with two colors and diagram your drills, when it becomes conflict or there's two different things happening in a forward and a D, the better teacher you'll be. The more you use black and you just go like this all the time, like if you think that they don't have hockey sense, they really won't have hockey sense when they're done with it. Like they will not know it, but you just go black all over. Like they're just lost. It's the honest to God truth. I can't put it to you any other way. You can make the choice if you want, but you'll be a better teacher and use colors. Go ahead. Okay, post game comments, real quick, we'll go through this. Only speak in the directions. I already talked about this with regards to travel. Never talk to the team about the game. Now, I should probably elaborate on that. If I'm a youth coach in here, and I've coached youth a lot in my life, a ton, would I ever go in, you know, as a Peewee or Bantam through my years, and you know, I might want to tell my kids great job because I think I got a good personality, I want to have fun with them, I might go high five them all, you know, I might do that, I've done that my whole career, there's nothing wrong with that. But in terms of giving them some type of internal fuel that I'm feeling, whether it's positive or negative, not a chance. Not a chance. I just wouldn't do that. We're vulnerable as teachers and coaches to say verbiage, things wrong during the heat of the battle. One of the best tips I can give you today is disengage, absorb it, stay calm, relax, address it with your aggressive. Talk it through with your assistant coaches. It's just the truth. I've been with coaches that have, and I'm not going to say names, physically abused players after the game. I've been with coaches on the ice that have shot pucks at players. I've been through it all, and every one of those coaches was always in trouble because their emotions got the best of everything they did, not only in practice, but in games, and post-games, and speeches, everything. I think one of the best oftentimes, like right now for you, like, and I just say this as a teacher, I know everybody in the room and which one of you are attentive and which one of you are constantly leaned over. And I know why you're probably leaned over, and I can tell by your eye contact whether you're with me or not with me. You all are telling me a story. That doesn't make you good or bad people. I'm just telling you, you're telling me a story as a teacher. And that's what you, if you can get to that point as a teacher, and you can start to look at the way your kids are responding and looking at you, how attentive they are, and how attentive you are to their needs, you will find, whether you're paid or not paid, this is one of the most gratifying experiences you'll ever have in your life. But you're gonna have to be able to read people, feel people, and sense it. That's what makes you good at what you do. You have no thought process in that. It's a tough business to be successful. You can tell yourself you're successful, but you're probably not in the eyes of your employees. You're just not, okay? So make sure that you can read body language as a teacher as you mature and you go through the process. Go ahead. Sometimes we call them opposite, they'll probably be emotion versus message, okay? So that, those are things we talk about. Teaching methods of the game. Okay, the process. Let's get it. The process versus the result. The result of the game. Go ahead, Terry. Okay. Okay, so the process versus the result. What was the result of the game? Okay, that's what you're addressing in your head as a head coach or assistant. Result of the shot clock, it kind of gives you an indication of maybe what would happen, but every building is different, so you can't really trust it unless you do it on your own. Result of scoring chances. Here's an interesting thing. How many know what scoring chances are in the game? Raise your hand. Okay? Some of you and a lot of you don't. Here's the end all of the game. Whether you're a boy or girl in the room or you're coaching a boy or girl, you can't ask them to score a goal. That is very, 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 very unfair. Cannot ask them. It's not fair. You can ask them to produce scoring chances more than they give up. I don't care if you score. Just hopefully get more scoring chances for our team than you would give up defensively for our team. So if you take and you do the math, Wayne's our best player in the room. Okay, Wayne gets, let's just say he's U12. He gets 7 chances here, C plus A. You help by pass or by shot, you help produce 7 grade A scoring chances in our game. On the other side of it, you're on the other end, and you have a really good stick position, you're always accountable defensively, and the chances that they got when you've been on the ice, you're only been marked for 2. So 7-2, you're a plus 5 in the game. You end up being our top forward in the game in terms of scoring chances. Being like, great, I might not say nothing after the game, I know it, but I can wait the next day. Didn't score, but what more could I ask? Had some really good looks, just didn't work. But I'm hopeful between me and you that you get another 7 the next game on Sunday, and if you could take the 2-1, I'll give you a fist bump. That's it. That's all I can ask. I can't ask people to score goals. It's unfair. So, you as a youth coach, would you get into scoring chances? The answer is no. You're not. But you, if you're educated, you'd be like, well, Wayne, you're the head coach, first name?
Luke.
Wayne and Luke. On the bench together, Wayne looks at Luke. Luke's running the D. Wayne goes, Luke, Troy, like, he must have 3 or 4 A chances for us, didn't he? Yeah, as a D. Did he give up any? Like, when he was out there, they never got a chance. Yeah, I'd have him as a 4-0. Keep Troy going, man. Keep him going. Keep him going. Whatever you're saying, it's awesome. That's a conversation. On the other side of it, it might go Luke to Wayne, forward side. Hey, what else Troy doing down there?
Yeah.
I don't know. He just doesn't have it. All right. Well, what are we doing? We need to give him some encouragement. Wayne says, you know what? For whatever reason, my voice isn't working with him. Luke's like, all right, I got it. Luke walks to the other bench, looks down to Troy. Going, okay, hang in there. Hang in there. Keep whatever the message is. Switch up the messenger, switch up the idea of how he's doing, and then boom, something ignites usually. It ignites because there's a different voice, different tone, different posture. Beard, intimidating. Light beard, not so intimidating. How you look, how you posture yourself, that's the way it works. Tone of voice, size, everything. These are all indicators of how I'm going to perceive you as a teacher. So, you know, you're looking to identify scoring chances only for the fact that it would give you a better understanding of the game. We'll get into what scoring chances at some other point in time, if that's what that means. Result of the athletes, Eau Claire North versus Eau Claire Memorial. It's not in the room. Obviously, those athletes care. It's an in-town rivalry, right? They care about who wins and who loses. Result of management organization, that's as you get older. Result of the agents, parents, that's as you get older. I go through that every day. We refer to the pyramid for direction. We go right back to it. So when I get to the process, I go back to the pyramid. Whatever your pyramid is that you design, if you wanted to design one, you don't have to, but if you did, it'll make you always go back. And the repetitiveness of how you talk about forming good habits, playing smart, playing hard, playing as a team, that repetition will make and produce not only good players, but really, really good people. It'll be like, this person's really process-driven. Yeah, they do care about my results or our team results, for sure. They're prideful. You wear this jersey with pride, but they're really patient. They're really good. Okay, Terry, go ahead. Whiteboard is a teacher. Now we're going to get into this other couple of things I'm just going to mention. We're going to get more into these. Part, whole, part. What does that mean? Who's our teachers in the room? Who teaches for a living? What age?
College.
College? Perfect. Somebody else had a hand up over there. What do you teach?
Eighth grade.
Eighth grade. What's part, whole, part mean? Putting you on the spot.
Yeah.
In hockey, what is part, whole, part mean? College professor.
In medicine, we used to do this with like four stroke patients, for instance. So you teach part of the skill, and you teach the whole skill, and then you teach another part of the skill.
Perfect. That's what it is. All of you that want to be great teachers, when it gets down to drill execution, players that want to grow and become smarter, learn part of the drill, then do the whole drill, then part of the drill. The best teachers in the game will say, if you're working on LRF, which stands for Line Rush 4 tonight, so that's the attack. So you say, all right, we're working on the LRF. We're going to work on a 2-on-1. Okay, we're just working on a 2-on-1's LRF. But I'm going to work on offense at the puck and offense away from the puck. I'm working on LRF. That's just part. I'm just working on one part tonight. The next day you come in and you go, we're doing the whole. We've taught all the parts, we've taught the D how to play, we've taught the forwards how to play at and away from the puck. Now it's a whole drill. Let's say you run a different drill. And then you're like, oop, wait, you're back at it. You're like, geez, Tuesday we did a whole of the 2-on-1. You're like, as a D coach, you're like, or the forward coach, you're like, yeah, we didn't pass early enough, we didn't execute right. And you're like, well, my D caved in. All right, perfect. We go back to a 2-on-1 drill. We've got to teach the other part. They don't understand the whole yet because we haven't got through enough parts. Then all of a sudden it starts to click in. Then it's like, oh, okay. Then you go back to a whole. So you go part, whole, part, or you go whole, part, whole. It depends on your age and what you're coaching. One puck drills is what we're going to get into eventually, not so much tonight.
756.
So we're not going to get into the all the one puck drills, but what's the beauty of a one puck drill? It's just like the game. So if we're out on this ice sheet as a group of teachers and coaches and we split the ice in half, then I would say to you this year, I'm going to teach you, which way do you want to split? Red line or at an angle? Full ice. It's a 200 foot game. So at times, we might have to do a split. If we're two squirt coaches, we might have to do a split full ice. Because I got to work on 2-on-1s, and I got to work on 1-on-1s, and I really need to work on gapping, and I really need to work on closing. And the other coach is like, exactly, I'm on the other side, and we need full ice 2-on-1s because we can't do parts anymore. We just can't cut the ice in half. Like, even though we put four nets out there, we'll go side to side. Then you're like trying to draw lines in the ice, you're trying to figure it out. Kids they're just lost. They, because all these markings on the ice that they're going to put on ultimately tell you how to teach. The hash marks mean something. The goal line means something. All the dots mean something to how you actually play the game. I need to teach you that, and I will help you all year with that. But you need to understand that. So that helps you teach. So one puck drills are critical for retention because it's just like a game. There's two colors and one puck. That's the game. So you try and do as many of those as you can. Numbers and colors, that's tactics, repetition over and over, tempo, focus of the staff on the ice, execution of the success. This will differ in the room greatly. Tempo is the focus of the staff on the ice. That's we'll get into that more in a little bit. Go ahead, next one. Skill development. Skill development by time, I just said non-resistant, resistant, coach resistant, situational resistant, goal, positional, goalie, lead forwards. These are when you get into the skill development part of the game. Go ahead. We're going to get more into this, goalie and defense together. Cardinal part, go ahead. Breaking down by part of the game, teaching the whole piece of the game, breaking it back down by part of the game, and the whiteboard, back one, with your back. There's the magic of the system stuff. So if you start to get into part whole part, and you start to do your drills, you're figuring out your drills, then you want to be, as a teacher, he wants to be like, hey, we're working on D-zone coverage. Even though we got half ice, I need your brains to focus on D-zone coverage, but today the part we're working on is rivaling coverage. So I want you to understand you're crossing the blue line between after the red, because our half ice is this way. I need you to enter into the defensive zone, and we're going to work on coverage, but I'm really focused on how you get back into the ease. That's all we're really focused on, this part of the game. Then let's say you do that for a little bit, you have the defensive zone theme to your practice, let's say, and the next drill you do is a whole drill. It's like all D-zone coverage. Then the next drill you do is another part, and you go to the corners and you say, this is the math, we want to play 2-on-2 in the corner, and we want our center to come in and help, or whatever you're deciding you're going to do tactically, then it's another part. So you understand, I did a part of the rival, I did the whole D-zone coverage with like one puck or however I did it. Then I did another part. By the time they leave my practice on that particular night, they've had a lot of defensive zone coverage and they should know, they start to feel like how to go, how to the pace, how does my stick play, how does my repetition go ahead. So that's the beauty of part one part. One puck drills, go back. Keep going. Offense, defense, we talked about that. Numbers and colors, jerseys. Colors, pro hockey, we talked about that, reading the play, numbers of the situations, colors of the situations, we talked about that. Repetition, creates habits and good fundamentals, 21 times becomes a habit, keep going, how many drills do you have, keep going. Alright, now we get into a beautiful screen. Pie chart. This is really, now I'm finishing the whole presentation, we're right at the end, as you can tell. But this is the beauty of really what I have to do as a teacher. Okay, so all of you as players, number one, participating in the game, the teachers that are in the room as coaches, to really do it really quick to see how you can add this up. Our job as a group is we have 40 and 40. We have to teach 80% of the time what to do away from. 80%. Nicole's got 80% within her drills and what she's trying to do, depending on her age, she's got to teach everybody how to play away from the puck, both offensive and defense. So how do you get into that? That's elite. Somebody would be like, Troy, not a chance. I'm just happy I'm here and I'm hoping you're done in 10 minutes. That's not going to happen this year, but I'll listen. Okay? Here's the beauty of becoming a really good hockey team. We have a few kids in the room that are players that are going to have the puck maybe 10% of their shift. Every shift is 100%. Well, in here, let's just take, I won't ask the high school kids. We might have one player or two players that might have the puck 10% of their shift in high school games. We might have a couple. That's it. We might maybe have one elite player. He's at 18%. So then then you're saying, okay, well, what is he doing when he doesn't have the puck, but our team has the puck? Well, the 10 and the 40, that's the 50%. 10 and the 40 here, that's the 50%. That's your 100%, your shift, every time you go off. The beauty of what I'm going to try and help you through the next two more sessions after we finish here is, how do you teach this at and away from the puck? That's where you really become an elite teacher, elite coach. But let's say you can't get there after 3 weeks. I'm totally cool with that. You've got my number and email 24/7. You can always utilize me. But at the same time, if you understand more than you did a year ago, your lens will change as to how you go about your business as a teacher slash coach. Your lens will change. Because now you're going to be like, oh, and Cole's like, oh, that's the man? Holy. Rhyming. That means like, okay, so I've been doing these drills for the last 2 years, and I don't think we teach anything away from the puck. No problem. So to get back to Stacy, and to get back to everybody that's been up here, Stacy being the leader of the group, like, that's kind of why I'm here, is to try and teach you, like, how do you do drills where you actually have somebody on your staff that's accountable for playing without the puck. If you said that the group of men in this room were your pride and joy as a group of youth teachers, and every year you're together, that this group would shine, it will be because of this slide. I will tell you, it's that simple. You can take all the other hour and 15, 20 minutes I said, this is it right here. You have to be able to teach what to do in drills away from the pocket or in the color. That's the hardest part. This is where hockey IQ is. And to answer your question, even though you didn't ask it, but you're thinking it, can you teach hockey sense or hockey IQ? You either got it or you don't. You can teach a feel. You can say, oh, I'm going to let them feel it through my drills and the way I look at things. They're going to have a little better feel. But the innate ability of understanding hockey IQ and hockey sense is usually God-given. It's, you know, you take Scotty Bowman, you take all the best coaches, they're going to say it's a non-teachable trait. Okay? But I always like to have hope because I'm obsessed. So I like to think that I can change people. Reality is, sometimes I couldn't, but I could teach the feel. I could teach how to sense and feel, like how to feel things and how to sense it, how to feel the game a little bit. But this is really where we get into our ability to really be great teachers. We're going to get into this a lot next week. So, who has the puck, break down the game management, that's your shift, 100%. And like I said, these numbers will all shore up for kids in your group. So let's say, give me a kid, might be make believe, last year's best player on your team.
John.
Okay. Where do you think John, what do you think he's coaching?
I actually didn't coach for the part of the
Part of the Valley group? Okay. So how? Where do you think John fit into this number as your best player, even though his name wasn't John?
In terms of what percentage?
Yeah. What do you think he was in the game at the Valley level? 15%. What do you think he was at this? Was he a forward or D?
Forward.
Okay, what do you think he was here?
Five.
Okay, so you have 45% that can teach what to do in a defensive zone. How is John's hockey IQ? Strong? Okay. So now you take your time with John, that's 15, that goes to 35, okay? This is, like you said, whatever, 5, and this is 45. Well, then now when you discuss John as a player, as a staff, and you're working on John, your approach to John is totally different than it is to Troy. Troy's got 2% of the puck offensively. This dude struggles. So how we work with Troy is way different than we work with John, and we should be very cognizant of that. Yes, he might use some of the same drills, but now I'm going to save you over the next 3 weeks. You two as a head coach and assistant, in terms of being passionate about being a good teacher, you have to discuss Troy and John. And the way you communicate with Troy and John is going to be slightly different if you're really into what you're doing. You want to make them better. But then I'm going to say to you, is that a lot of work? Yes, the answer is yes. But that's what separates youth groups from other youth groups. It's their ability to teach. And it takes reps even for us as adults. So that's kind of where we're going. It doesn't mean we're going to get to the end all right away. This might take time. I'm good with it. It's a process. Next one, Terry. Practice repetition is critical for individuals and team success. Create habits and new fundamentals. 21 times. Keep going. So now we just look at what we're doing. So we're going to really talk about how I can make you better at practice as teachers and different things here. Then, you know, there isn't a lot of this in terms of, it depends on the age, but I have to put it in there as a teacher. Then there's then we play the game. So we kind of talked about this. This would be getting into, like, this is our breakout versus their forecheck if you're the band coaches. And you want to get into that this year. You want to give them a little bit more. So you give them prepare for the opponent type thing. Then you're going to play the game. Then after the game is a staff. In this case, Luke and Wayne. You guys are going to now figure this out, right? So now you're going to have an analysis of what happened. And hopefully that's somewhat spend some time on it. Collecting your thoughts and coming together. Then you're going to get a practice plan based on all of this taking place. And this has to be right and this to be right. Okay? When I first learned how to coach, great quick story. I was with Mike Eaves at Eau Claire. Okay, he was the head coach. He had just gotten out of the Stanley Cup. He was actually coaching for the Calgary Flames in 1986, the Stanley Cup Finals. He was an assistant coach. Because of all the injuries with the Flames during the playoffs, they actually put him in the lineup as a coach back in those days. So he was in phenomenal shape, obviously. He went from being a player to a coach, now he's put him back in the Stanley Cup. Steve Kirk, who was the AD at the time at Eau Claire, he flew all the way to Calgary for game two, I don't know, it was one of those two, to interview Mike, saying Mike wanted to come back to the state of Wisconsin because his wife was from Madison. So he played for the Badgers, so he wanted to come back and coach. So the AD at Eau Claire went all the way up to the Stanley Cup, Mike gave a ticket, they interviewed, Mike agreed to the job. I'm coming to Eau Claire to be your coach. Came to the coach. So I go in to meet with Mike. I'm asking to be his assistant. I just played 2 years prior to that as a senior. And I said, hey, I'd like to be the assistant. And he's like, okay. And he met with me and said, okay, you be my assistant. So then he says, well, what do you do? And he goes, I have zero money to pay. You'll make no money. I'm like, perfect. He goes, the worst news is, do you have a job? Like, yeah, I have two jobs because I got to make a living. He goes, what do you do? I said, I bartend at the Brock Cabin. Don't take that. Like, yeah, I don't have a booze issue, but I do bartend at the Then I get a lap of Luigi's sub, and I usually get home at 3:30. But then sometimes I don't sleep, because I got to be the YMCA in downtown Eau Claire at 4:30 to open up the door so I can give all the old men towels for their swim, sauna, whatever. I'm handing out towels. I hand out towels from 4:30 in the morning until 10 a.m. He goes, perfect. Does that make you much money? I mean, what do you think? Nope. He goes, well, you're going to have to spend some of that money that you make in truth, because you're going to have to drive in cities and watch players. Perfect. I want to be a coach, so I'm going to do it. Okay. Then he says, I want you in my office at 10:30. 10:30? Practicing. Like, 2:30? 10:30? He goes, yep, drive up to McPhee, watch you there at 10:30. He goes, I'll have my wife, Bethy, make you a sandwich every day. So you just get out of the YMCA, drive to McPhee Park, and I'm going to teach you how to run a practice. Like, is it that hard? Like, how long have we worked on practice? It's like 2 hours. Like, 2 hours for a practice? Yep. Like, so that puts us till 12:30. Yep, then we got to get in the car, get down to Hobbs, and we got to get on the ice at 2. We need to get down there and make sure the players are good, everything's going right, so we got to be in there by 10:01. We're on the ice at 2. Like, okay. So I'm like, this is going on. A sidebar in this whole thing, I'm getting sandwiches. Guys, I'm actually 23 years old. His wife is making me a tomato sandwich with Brussels sprouts on wheat bread that you'd have to butter the crap out of to have any flavor. And I'm like, I go through about 2 weeks of this, and I'm like, I can't do this anymore. If I'm going to be a good coach, I as amateurs. I'm good. I'll pull in McDonald's. What I said earlier. I'll pull in McDonald's on the way to Hobbs. So then we get back to the practice thing. I go, why don't we practice for 2 hours? He goes, because that's what Bob Johnson does. He's the best coach ever. I'm like, well, that's a pretty good guy to bother yourself after. He goes, Bob would spend 2 hours on practicing every detail down to a T. We will do the same. So when I'm doing something, you will be doing exactly what I tell you to do in some other part of the ice. I'm like, okay. He goes, if you lean on your stick, sit on the board, or get caught standing very long, you'll feel me and you'll hear me. You're going to move. Okay. That was how I learned. So had I not learned that from a good teacher, Mike's a good teacher, emotional leader, but a good teacher. But had I not done that, I don't know where I'd be. So 2 hours it took us to figure out practice. I got rid of the sandwiches, less than hard about me. I got rid of those. And it really taught me how to prepare and plan for a practice. So this whole stuff here, not that I expect you guys to spend 2 hours on practice. But it does take time to put together a good practice. Last part of the story, another part of being a good teacher. So I get on the ice, and Mike's, you guys know Mike? He's a friend, he's a little on the ball. And he's like at a zero, and all of a sudden he's at a 10. So I'm like, going out there, and I'm really excited. I'm with a guy that just got out of Stanley Cup. This guy played for the Minnesota North Stars when I was a kid. Like your guys' age. Like, I don't know. So I'm out on the ice and I'm going around and he's like on my end and he's on his end and we're doing separate drills and practice is over and he comes down and he just basically whacks me upside the legs. I have no shins on, he just hits me right through these pants, wind pants. He goes, what the hell was that? And I'm like, what? He goes, what the hell was that down here? I'm like, we did what we're supposed to do. What the hell are you doing with that whistle? Sucking on it. What the hell's wrong with you? It's all emotional. I was like, whoa. You don't suck on a whistle. A whistle is authority. You tweet it hard. If you want to tweet it twice, you tweet it twice and you're done. You don't blow into it really soft. You don't suck on it. It's a whistle of authority. It teaches people how to react. If you don't want to blow your whistle, I'm good. Then you'd be a stick fighter. Bob Johnson sometimes is a stick fighter. He just, that's it. Drill's done. Tap the ice, it wouldn't blow us. But he goes, your whistle is an indicator of your teaching ability. That's another little lesson I learned. So I was at my team in Sioux City this last week and I had one assistant and I'd give him the same speech with a little different tone. Obviously it's 2022, not 1986. But I gave it to him and he was like, yeah, no one's ever told me. So the whole practice thing, we get into all that over time, is really a good thing to do. We have a really lot to cover, but I'm going to talk about a couple other things first. So next week, the idea was with Stacy and the board was that tonight I would just do an introductory, kind of like getting your head around becoming a good teacher and looking at the game a certain way with our language and things like that. Then we have to get into really like how to prepare a practice. And that's going to be fun because it will be a whole bunch of information sharing, but that's probably next week. And it will be also offense and terminology. How we look at the game offensively, how do we teach it, and then the following week will be defensive. So that's kind of our plan. What I would ask out of you as a group is if you could come here with some questions per your age, that would be awesome. The other thing I would really would be appreciative if when you come back, if you are assigned where you are, which it might not be according to what Stacy said, but if you have an idea maybe who you're going to coach with, sit next to him because there's going to be a little interaction. I'd like you to sitting by somebody you kind of know you're going to act, I'll allow you to discuss a couple of things here as well about the presentation. It'll be way less of this. This is a lot. It'll be more of like, okay, here's the paperwork I've given you. Now we're going to get through it. How do we lay out practice? How do we look at drills? Talk about part, whole part. How does this work? I've got it broken down. So I've got drills to give you and then show you examples of how you take a part of the drill and a whole drill and part of the drill, things like that and that nature. So does that make sense? Okay, I've covered a lot. I haven't given you a lot of time for questions. We've got to have some questions as to something that I've taught. Terry?
Yeah, one slide you had to talk to your talk to your team after the game, and it said something about no film in capital letters. Could you explain what that was?
Yeah, no film would be, we don't have film, so I can't back it, and I haven't watched the film. So I'd be really, really loose. But that's at a really probably a higher level. But a lot of you nowadays, you have iPads, and you have parents filming the games, and you want to look at things, and maybe depending on your age, maybe you do, maybe you don't, maybe it's not. But I would say that maybe, you know, things might change, and you're more educated, and I can really be a good teacher to all of you. You might, your passion versus obsession might change. So you might become a little bit more obsessed to learn a little bit more, so you're speaking a little bit more cleanly. But if I don't have film, I don't like to really hold anybody accountable until I watch film. Because film does a lot, but that's at a higher level. So you think of like your background here, Nicole, all in
second year.
So if you look at your repetitions in teaching and coaching, you probably would say, I'm assuming if you're not, it's fine, but you'd probably say, I'm kind of comfortable with sitting behind the bench and understanding the game, but to actually hold somebody accountable for something, I wasn't sure if I saw it the right way anyway. So I'd rather refer to, I either saw it on an iPad or I saw it or I asked my assistants before I addressed that issue, because I wasn't in that player's shoes. So you look at the game a little bit differently. If you had film and you watch film and you could take it back to Troy the next day and you could show him something on the iPad that you felt was important for my development, you'd probably feel really comfortable as a teacher doing it through film. It's when you don't have film that you kind of got to step back and say, I'm not sure if I saw it right. It's kind of like the same way you look at refereeing. Refereeing is, quite frankly, it is what it is. Let's just say that. Okay. But here's what I would say about refereeing. Is there a referee in here?
Stucks.
You know,
referees are people too short.
That's right. Referees are people too short. And his dad was a very good referee, so I'm sure Stucks is the same way.
Yeah, sometimes.
Referees are good people. I've handled referees because I've been a senior vice president of the East Coast League when I was out of coaching for a year, going through divorce. Life was tough, and I got out of coaching for reasons and ended up becoming a senior vice president. I ran the East Coast Hockey League, which is a professional league. And I had to deal with the referees all the time. You know, so I became their friend. And they're no different than U.S. staffs. They're the same. You guys think you have a couple of beers, gals, and you drink your beer, and you love them, and you go and you hang out with hotels, and they're your best friends, right? Referees are no different. They're really no different. They're all buddies, and they all talk. And so every one of you that might be Luke will just pick on you, that you're a little sharp tongue behind the bench and get some issues. They all probably know that before the game starts, no matter where they're coming from, that gets Luke's abuse, you know. So they probably already know that. But the one thing when you talk about film, to your point of learning the game, the one thing we can do as a group of teachers and coaches is we can challenge a referee's work ethic and position. That's it. All truthfully you can ask for. I could say to Stuck, you think you worked hard to get to that spot, and were you in the right spot, or did the net clog your view? Stuck would probably say, knowing Stuck, he'd probably say, you know, Wardo, I didn't get to the wall as fast as I thought I could have, but I think I still saw the play pretty well and I like my call. But I take note to your work ethic. I take note to your position and that call. So that's like a part of the film. It's the way you handle the referees too. It's the same way. Yeah.
I was just going to ask, at what age group do you think it is appropriate to utilize film and for practice, and at what point do you do it, and then how much other practice would you use film?
I wouldn't use it a ton. I'll give you an example of summer hockey. So I have hockey and sons and hockey and daughters. Okay, that's a parent-child camp, whether it's mom or dad. I got 800 people a summer. So I got people from all over the world coming to this camp, okay? And we do film. We actually do film. And so they're in a camp that's only 3 days long. But I'll tell you what, from basically 9-year-olds all the way up, you show a little bit of film and you watch them play, it's powerful. It is powerful. But we're at a camp setting. I have control of the camera. I have time with my staff to look at some film. it's different than your lives as people and dads and working a job. I totally understand that. Respect your whole lifestyle and what you're trying to do on behalf of this city to help it. So it's not always feasible at your levels, but I do believe from my experience for doing it. I've had Hockey and Sons for 25 years. I've been teaching youth in the summer through video for 25 years. It's powerful, but we have the tools to do it, right? We have the setting to do it, so it's a little bit different. I'll temper it with that. But kids are right, kids understand. And when you can show them, and then we change it to answer your question. Your first name is?
Adam.
We change it also, we mix in a lot of NHL video. So we cut shifts of NHL players. So if we're teaching a skill, you know, we'll break it down and we'll say, like, this is so-and-so doing this particular skill and he's on his inside edges. And the kids go, oh, they made us work on the inside edge. And now, you know, now I see it in action. Crosby spends his whole game in the offensive zone on his inside edges. That makes sense. So there's some power to it. Yes, question.
So Virginia had a slide you got here for the practice game cycle.
Yep.
So specifically, I'm from Minnesota, I've been to Wisconsin, but the thing I noticed over here is we play all our games in the weekends.
Correct.
So for the practice game cycle, it's like a couple practices, then three, four, five games in a weekend.
Yep.
And it's, so you practice for like, you're not practicing for an opponent or a certain team, you're just kind of...
One game to the next.
Right, and is there any sort of, in a perfect world, sort of what is the number of practices to number of, to a game that you'd like to see, or you know what I mean? Like, is there, do you want to have one or two practices to set up for a specific game, or is it okay to have, you know, a couple of games during the week and then have three or four games on the weekend?
Every city is different, every organization is different, as you know, from being from Minnesota to here. You have to deal with whatever you're given, whether it's a Tuesday, Thursday, and that's what you get for your practices, and then you have three games on the weekend, and you have no in-between ice, obviously. Then you just compile your information and try and get into the next week. But I think what's helpful is if you understand that your time here through the next weeks to maybe bridge that question you have even better for you, is that if you get into your drills and they're part, whole part, you can get a lot done during the week to fix the issues you might have had in three straight games. Okay, so you can get more done. What happens with coaching in general is that we're all just good people that are trying and we're volunteering, like I said. I really believe in that. And I know where you're at and you're developing and the whole thing, but we tend to be coaches that will get accustomed to a few drills. We like our favorite drills, and then we just stick with them, but they don't really have any real weight in what we're trying to do to improve kids. We like to say it's a skill development or skating drill, but the application could be so much more if we know more about the game. And that's the thing, like, I'll use an example. We're getting ahead of ourselves. What time is it?
8:26.
So we're about done. These two are coaches, and like, in my belief is that as a staff, I would work with all of you to say, you know what, I need you this year to really focus on what we do with the puck, and I need you to focus with what we do about it. And then you bring your concerns to me before we hit the ice on Tuesday, let's talk about it. You bring your concerns about what we're doing, and then you teach. And you say, it looks like where our team is at, we're really behind in the defensive part of the game, and we're doing pretty well with our group physically and skill-wise with the offensive part. I think we should just let that mature on its own right now, but we have to focus on how to teach these kids how to play away from the puck. So then you get into your part hole, part drills, you understand which part of your team is going in the right direction, which part's not. When you sit together as a staff and you both basically look at the game the same way with no at the puck, away from the puck, no offense or defense lens, and you're supposed to cover it all, I think it gets really tough as a volunteer. I think it gets really tough. You two are sitting next to each other. You like each other?
Not really.
Not really? I think it's pretty funny, by the way. What's your name?
Nolan.
Tucker. So I'll just pick out Nolan and Tucker. These guys are basically working together. They're basically coaching the same team. They're sitting together today. The more cohesive these two guys are relative to the development, how they see the game, the better off I can make them really fast over the next 2 months. Especially when I get to Tucker and I say, Tucker, did you play? He says, yes. And he's a pretty good offensive player back in the day. Perfect. You're going to run the offense. He says, well, I'll cover the defense. And then we start to look at it through a different lens. runs and how we run drills and how we get feedback, your kids will just take off. Because now both of you are constantly involved in practice. Both of you know that you have edges on your skates and you're moving and you're talking, and then all of a sudden the whole team, the whole temperature changes. It just changes based on how you look at the group and how you divide it. That's critical. That's really critical. If we're a really good organization moving forward, all of you will need to get your skate sharpened at least once every 3 weeks. That means you're actually skating and moving and working. Those of you that sharpen them in October and you do it again in March before you put them away, you probably haven't done much the whole winter. No disrespect. I mean none. I'm just trying to be straightforward with you and helpful. But the good coaches get on their edges, they're moving, they're getting down to kids' level. I got a U12, I got to get down to this level, I got to bend, I got to talk. I might have to go down to one knee, take my glove off, I'll talk Luke eye to eye. This presence isn't intimidating. How I deliver the message and my tone is not intimidating as a teacher. But if I stand over Luke and I have no edges and I haven't broken a sweat and Luke looks at me in the corner, think of the high school kids. No disrespect to the coaches. And Terry's over there like this, watching practice. And fair enough, you're smart guys. And Terry comes over and says something, well, you'd be like, okay, he said he was here for 50 years. Like, I respect that, but this dude hasn't moved in 15 minutes. I really don't know if I'm going to take a lot of what he's got to say with me with a grain of salt right now. He has not moved in 15 minutes. So these things are all part of becoming a good teacher. And I need you to just wrap your head around it, be open-minded to change, and go, geez, if I can just pick up some of these things, regardless of where my hockey IQ goes and how much I understand, I think I can put myself in a different position. And if I can work different with my support cast, I think we can get a lot more done. Because it's impossible. It's impossible as a head coach. It's really, really hard. We're a team just like your team. We have to work together and work through our things. Any other questions? Otherwise, I would like to really stay on time because you have people that are being respectful for your time here. It's important to stay on time. The only other last thing I will say this, sorry, Harry. I don't know what your organization is going to do, but if you said to me, whether it was in Europe, all the different places I've coached in South Korea, I've coached everywhere. And I don't mean that in a good or bad way, I'm just being truthful with you. If you're going to be a good teacher, you have to look like a teacher. I wore this not for the reason of wearing it. I wore all of the stuff that has the logo and the colors because if I get on the ice and I look like this, that means I look like a teacher and I'm going to get respected. If you don't, you're going to get into your personality and your habits as a human being that will flaw you. Your ability to coach or teach will not flaw you as much as your look and your tone and how you act. It's going to flaw you. Your respect is going to be different. How much the board asks you to be back and be a part of it, it's respectful. Like if we're going to teach the Menominee people, we're going to teach them to be better, we should look appropriate, we should have a whistle on, we should act as if. It's really, really important. If you look at the best professions in the world, we trust people. They look a certain way, they act a certain way, and they speak a certain way. It's hard to be an effective teacher and get respect if you look like you just got off your job. It's really hard. So, and I've already told this to Stacy, the board, when they came over to my office at my home. You know, I said, if you invest in tracksuits for the staff and you all look all right, it's powerful. When you walk into a rink in Halley or wherever you're walking into, Altoona, I don't care, Hudson, it makes a big difference, people. It's like, man, I'd like to be a part of something like that. They look good, they act right, it's just, it's an aura about them. So that's the last thing I'll leave you. That's why I wore this, is just to show you that I think it's really important that you look the part. So thanks for your time.
Next 2 Mondays, 6:30, so let's get here a little bit early. High school guys, if you'll stop back here in the corner with me just for a minute.
Thank you, Troy.